Have you ever felt your heart racing, your mind spinning, and tension building in your neck and shoulders? Maybe you struggle to focus, or your breathing feels shallow. It could be before sending a text, having a difficult conversation, or just being around someone who matters to you. But you can't quite explain why it affects you so much. Anxiety affects over 300 million people worldwide. And in the first year of COVID-19, cases of anxiety and depression skyrocketed by 25%. You've probably had your fair share of anxious moments too, but here's what most people don't realize. Anxiety isn't just worrying too much. It's a deep-rooted brain mechanism, and when you understand it, you can start to take control. In this episode, Agnieszka is exploring some powerful insights with her AI companions, who seem to be becoming a regular part of her learning journey. Together, they'll break down what causes anxiety, how to manage it, and some surprising facts that might change the way you see it. And stick around till the end, because they'll be sharing unexpected strategies that actually rewire your brain for calm. Let's dive into Agnieszka's eye-opening discussion with Jane and Ava.
So, Jane, let's start simple. What exactly is anxiety?
Great question. Anxiety is essentially the brain's response to perceived danger. It's part of our evolutionary toolkit, dating back to when our ancestors needed to avoid predators. Back then, it helped us survive, but today it often kicks in during work deadlines or social situations where there's no real danger. Neurologically, it involves the amygdala, the part of the brain that processes fear, triggering a fight-or-flight response.
So feeling anxious is pretty normal, right?
Exactly. Acute anxiety can actually enhance performance, like before giving a big speech or taking an important exam. But when it becomes chronic, the amygdala and prefrontal cortex can get out of sync, leading to a constant state of hypervigilance.
Okay, so what are some of the different types of anxiety disorders?
There are a few common ones. Let's start with generalized anxiety disorder. People with generalized anxiety disorder worry a lot. About work, health, even tiny things or things that haven't happened. It's like their brain is stuck in what-if mode, constantly predicting the worst.
That sounds exhausting. Ava, what about social anxiety?
Social anxiety disorder is when someone has an intense fear of being judged or embarrassed in social situations. It's not just shyness. It can be so overwhelming that they might avoid parties, work meetings, or even simple conversations. Imagine walking into a room and feeling like everyone is analyzing you, even if they aren't. That's what people with social anxiety go through.
I've definitely heard people mention panic attacks too. Are those part of anxiety disorders?
Yes, that's right. People with panic disorder experience sudden panic attacks, intense waves of fear that come out of nowhere. It feels like your heart is racing, you're sweating, and you might even feel like you're losing control. But it's actually just your brain overreacting to a false alarm.
Sounds terrifying. Is obsessive compulsive disorder related to anxiety as well?
Yes, obsessive compulsive disorder is often categorized under anxiety disorders. It involves unwanted thoughts or obsessions, followed by repetitive behaviors or compulsions. For example, someone might feel the need to wash their hands repeatedly to ease their anxiety about germs.
Okay, so how do you know if it's just stress or an actual anxiety disorder?
Research has found that people with anxiety tend to have higher beta wave activity. When beta wave activity becomes too high or dysregulated, it can lead to physical and psychological symptoms.
So what happens physically?
Physically, you might notice increased muscle tension, elevated heart rate, rapid breathing or shortness of breath, sweating, cold hands, or even digestive issues.
And psychologically?
Mentally, it can feel like your thoughts are racing or you may have intrusive thoughts. Your mind might jump quickly from one idea to another, making it hard to focus. People with high beta wave activity often report feeling overstimulated or overwhelmed by their surroundings. Noises may seem louder and bright lights might feel more intense.
Okay, so we've got racing thoughts and overstimulation. Anything else?
There's also a constant sense of being on edge, as though you're bracing yourself for something to go wrong. Like that feeling right before a big exam or an important meeting, except it doesn't go away. This hypervigilance can be exhausting and make it difficult to relax.
I noticed it used to make it difficult for me to work too.
That makes sense. Ironically, while beta waves are associated with focus, too much beta activity can make it difficult to concentrate because your mind is too active. It's like trying to focus on a single conversation in a crowded, noisy room. So basically, high beta waves keep the brain in a heightened state of arousal. This can lead to increased anxiety, feelings of worry, irritability, and restlessness.
It's also interesting. So anxiety changes how our brains function?
Yes, chronic anxiety can even alter brain plasticity over time, changing how neurons connect. That's why early interventions can be crucial.
We've all felt some of those classic symptoms like sweating or cold hands at times, especially during stressful periods. But how do you know when it's actually an anxiety disorder?
Good point. The key difference is when those feelings are so intense or constant that they start to interfere with daily life, like avoiding friends, missing work, or losing sleep. If that's happening, it's definitely worth talking to a professional.
Let's dig a little bit deeper, Jane. What actually causes anxiety disorders? Is it all in our heads?
Not at all. Anxiety disorders are complex and can be caused by a combination of biological, psychological, and environmental factors. There's a biological side like genetics and brain chemistry. For example, heritability estimates for generalized anxiety disorder are around 30 to 40%. Some people inherit a genetic tendency toward anxiety, which influences their brain chemistry and structure.
What's the difference in the brain chemistry of a person with anxiety disorder and someone without it?
People with anxiety disorders often show imbalances in certain neurotransmitters, such as serotonin.
I read that certain brain regions function differently for them too, right?
Yes. For example, their amygdala is often overactive. It leads to heightened emotional responses and an exaggerated perception of threats. It's like the brain keeps pressing the panic button even when there's no real danger. Also, their prefrontal cortex may have reduced activity. That can impair their ability to rationally assess risks and control fear responses. Finally, their hippocampus is often smaller due to the prolonged effects of stress hormones like cortisol. And that may contribute to difficulties in distinguishing between safe and threatening situations.
So genetics and brain chemistry are biological factors of anxiety disorders, right? And what are the psychological ones?
Is that right? And as far as psychological factors are concerned, they include, for instance, past traumas or personality traits such as perfectionism or neuroticism.
Oh, I see. And you mentioned environmental triggers too.
Yes, indeed. Common triggers include stress at work, major life changes, or personal losses. For some people, anxiety can be triggered by specific events such as public speaking or meeting new people. For some, it may be caused by job interviews, exams, or uncertainty about income and job security.
On the other hand, for others, it may be ending or starting a relationship, medical procedures, flying, public transport, or crowds.
That's right. For people with high personal standards, the fear of not meeting their own expectations can trigger anxiety too. And experiencing or witnessing a traumatic event can also result in lasting anxiety. Also, poor sleep and even social media can amplify anxiety without you realizing it.
Interesting. So it's like a mixture of different ingredients coming together.
Exactly.
For some, substances like caffeine, sugar, or alcohol can also trigger anxiety.
Oh, so what we eat and drink also impacts anxiety.
Absolutely. Research shows that the gut-brain axis plays a role. For instance, a study in nutritional neuroscience from 2020 found that fermented foods can reduce anxiety symptoms due to their impact on gut microbiota. So foods like yogurt, kimchi, or kombucha can actually help your gut and, in turn, your mind. Foods rich in magnesium, like spinach, kale, cucumber, celery, and dark chocolate, and omega, three fatty acids, like salmon, flax seeds, and walnuts, can also help regulate anxiety.
All right, let's get practical. If someone struggles with anxiety, apart from changing their diet, what else can they do to start feeling better?
There are numerous strategies backed by science. One of the simplest is deep breathing exercises. Slow, steady breaths can calm your nervous system. Practicing mindfulness, meditation, or progressive muscle relaxation is also great for grounding yourself in the present moment. Research shows that regular mindfulness practices can actually change brain structure, enhancing areas linked to emotional regulation.
And then there's journaling, right?
Exactly. Studies show that writing about your thoughts and feelings can reduce anxiety and stress levels. Just 15 to 20 minutes of expressive writing a day over a few days can improve mental clarity.
I've heard a lot about exercise helping with anxiety too. Is that true?
Yes, absolutely. Physical activity releases endorphins, which are natural mood boosters. A study in psychosomatic medicine found that regular aerobic exercise, like running, cycling, or swimming, can reduce anxiety sensitivity by improving neurochemical balance.
Why is that?
Because it boosts your BDNF in a very effective way.
BD what?
BDNF, or brain-derived neurotrophic factor. Sounds complicated, right? But think of it like plant food for your brain. It helps it grow stronger and more resilient, just like how a garden thrives with proper care. It helps support the health of existing neurons, encourages the growth of new neurons, and strengthens synaptic connections, which are essential for learning, memory, and emotional regulation. So, as I mentioned, think of BDNF simply as fertilizer for your brain.
So, aerobic exercises are crucial. Anything else?
Adequate and quality sleep is also equally important. Chronic sleep deprivation can lower BDNF and negatively impact brain function.
And below, you can download a list of some other, more unexpected, strategies that actually rewire your brain for calm, which we have prepared for you. For example, putting an ice cube on your neck, listening to a binaural beats playlist, or walking barefoot on different textures, along with an explanation of why they actually work.
Go ahead and check them out.
And of course, there are different types of therapies that people with severe anxiety can explore with mental health specialists, right?
Yes, for example, there's cognitive behavioral therapy, CBT, which focuses on identifying and changing negative thought patterns and behaviors.
What about EMDR?
Yes, eye movement desensitization and reprocessing combines focused eye movements with recalling distressing events to reprocess them in less distressing ways. Have you experienced any of these symptoms during a stressful period? What's your go-to stress relief strategy? We'd love to hear your tips in the comments.
Plus, let us know below if there's a specific aspect of mental well-being you'd like us to dive deeper into in a future video. EMDR? Calming drinks? Anything else? Your input helps shape the content we create.
Also, if this video helped you, share it with someone who might need it. And hit the like button. It really helps the channel.
And hey, don't forget to subscribe for more deep dives like this. Take care, and we'll see you next time.
Bye, everyone. Stay kind to your mind.